Welcome, and thank you very much for joining me this morning. My name is Mats Christensen, and I work in the ASP.NET and web tools team. So we basically build all the ASP.NET stuff, and we build all the web tools that goes into Visual Studio. And I have brought some new bits to show you guys. Brand new bits that has never been shown before. I hope you're okay with me showing you that. How many people here, I just want to get a feel for this. How many people here have tried Visual Studio 2013 preview? Hands up. Don't be shy. Okay, just a handful of you. How many in here use 2012? Oh, nice. That's over half. That's really good to see. So what I want to do is to take you through some of the updated features that we have in 2013. There's a lot of new stuff. Even though it's only been a year since we did 2012, we have so much new stuff that I want to show you. I'm going to show you the new HTML editor. We have a brand new one, and it's really, really cool. A lot of cool stuff in there. And then we're going to take a look at Web Essentials. How many people know or have installed Web Essentials? Hands up. Okay, just a few of you. So at the end of this, I'm sure that you're all going to go home and install it. There's a version for 2012, and there's now one for 2013 as well. So we're going to take a look at that. What I'm going to show you is going to be a mix between Web Essentials and Visual Studio 2013. So for those of you who don't know what Web Essentials is, it's a free download. It's a free add-on to Visual Studio, containing a lot of cool stuff for web developers. And then finally, we're going to take a look at Browser Link, this new magic connection between the browsers and Visual Studio. So as we go along here, feel free just to raise your hand and ask questions. I'm going to be moving through editors and through technology, so just raise your hand. I'll repeat the question so everyone can hear it, but just keep them coming, the questions. And I'm also going to leave a little bit of room at the end. And I hope that you have a lot of questions for me. And, of course, that I can answer them. We don't really have any secrets in the ASP.NET and web tools team, so I should be able to, if I know the answer, to answer all your questions. Before we dive into the code and into Visual Studio, I thought that I was just going to take a minute to say goodbye to a few good friends of ours. The Cassini web server and front page extensions are no longer in Visual Studio 2013. I'm sure they will be missed. But of course, Cassini and FrontPage, they were really great for their time, but we now have better technologies. So we've removed those from Visual Studio. We have IIS Express, it's now the default for all web, for all ASP.NET websites. And you can no longer publish using FrontPage extensions. It's not that common that we remove features from Visual Studio, but here it made sense for us. All right. Let's get to it here. So, here we go. All right. So, I assume that you're all web developers. And I assume that you also saw the developer stuff shown yesterday in the keynote in here. And one of the things that I did not show you was the stuff we have for JavaScript. We only had 10 minutes yesterday, so we sort of limited what we could show. But we do have a lot of cool stuff in JavaScript. So let's just take a look. One of the things that you have been asking for a long, long time, is document outline for JavaScript. You want to have a very, very easy overview of what functions you have in your JavaScript files. So in 2013, we now have the navigational dropdowns, just like in C Sharp. Make it really easy to jump around. It's alphabetically and all this sort of stuff, just as we know from C Sharp. So I'm sorry that it took so long to get this in there, but I hope that you're going to enjoy it. All right. So in 2012, and I'm sure that you have seen this, the JavaScript editor was brand new. We basically threw out the old JavaScript editor and built a new one. And we built it on top of the Internet Explorer JavaScript engine, Chakra. And that powers all of intelligence and all of validation and it's really fast and really, really cool. So we can do some new things in 2012. In 2013, we improved on top of that. So now we have a lot of ECMAScript 6 stuff in there, a lot of new concepts. And we improved IntelliSense as well. So let me just show you something that is kind of an issue with JavaScript. JavaScript as a language has some limitations. It's a dynamic language. And the language itself doesn't really know anything about types. A little bit it does, but not to the extent that we would want it to sometimes. Of course, now we have TypeScript. But if you want to use JavaScript, then take a look at this method or this function I have here called move. So the move method or function takes two parameters, an x and a y. Now let's see what happens if I invoke IntelliSense on x. I get this. It looks like something is broken with this warning out here. That's not the case. The thing here is that the JavaScript engine, the Chakra IE engine, does not know what X is. How would it know? We didn't tell it. And this is the problem with JavaScript and typing, is that we don't have this information. So the JavaScript editor just gives you what it can find of symbols. This is what you find in most other editors out there. They just give you statement completion of the symbols they find in the file. What would be even better is if we can tell JavaScript what we're going to do. Let's just try to call this move function from outside. So I'm just going to do it right here. It could be from a different file. But as I call it, you see it does show up in IntelliSense, and it does show me that it takes an x and a y. But it doesn't show me what x and a y is. Is it a string? Is it a number? What is it? We don't really know. So of course, if this was a number in C sharp, we would do something like this, right? JavaScript does not have that. So we can cheat. We can actually, in the editor, do what JavaScript, the language, cannot do. We can provide metadata in comments to enhance the experience. So what I'm doing here now is that I'm adding a few comments. These are the ones you know from C Sharp and Visual Basic, right? And I'm now describing what my function is doing and what the parameters are. So here we say that x and y are of type number. So if I now want to call my move function from the outside, it looks like this. We can now see that it wants a number. So this is really helpful, especially if you are in a team and you write JavaScript that other people, all the team members, are going to consume. You can now mark up your code to be really explanatory like this. But it's more than that. Because if I now type x dot, we now have IntelliSense of a number. Okay? So we actually augment the JavaScript editor by using this syntax. Now, there are some plugins out there for JS doc. So if you're a JS doc fan, you can use that. That's sort of a different type of markup for your comments. And we support both. So let's do this. X dot to string. Now, if I hit dot, I get IntelliSense of a string, right? No big surprise, because to string is always a string. But how did we find this out? The editor does not know anything about this. The editor has no concept of knowing that toString generates a string. So what happens behind the scenes is that we're going to pass in all the JavaScript in my file down to the JavaScript engine, Chakra, right? Which in 2012 was the IE10 JavaScript engine. In 2013 is the IE11 JavaScript engine. And that's going to run my code and return what type this is. And that's why I get string IntelliSense. So that's pretty nice. We can be a little bit cooler than that. And I have cheated. So now it gets a little bit more verbose here. But we can actually create multiple signatures in JavaScript. And by doing this, notice here the difference. The summary is the same, but one of these only takes the x parameter. And I say this is both the x and a y, whereas the other one takes both. So you know from C# and VB that you can do method overload. You can have the exact same method with the same name with different parameters, and they will both show up in IntelliSense and all that stuff, right? And compile just fine. JavaScript does not have this concept. But again, we can use tooling to emulate that browser, that JavaScript does this. So now when I call move, you can see that you actually get function overloads, something that JavaScript does not do. So this is really, really nice. And this exact same way we provide jQuery IntelliSense. So you see jQuery, we do the exact same thing. So we can say jQuery div.html. You see here, all this just flows through. You get full IntelliSense for all this stuff in jQuery. And we do it the exact same way I just showed you. But of course, the jQuery IntelliSense is all built in. Now, yesterday I showed you that we are trying to flow IntelliSense throughout CSS, HTML, and JavaScript. And we can now in JavaScript do stuff like this. So let me zoom in again here. We can now say document get element by ID, and I get all the IDs available in my project. These are IDs that I have used in my CSS or less files in my project. These are my IDs. That's pretty nice. I can do the same if I say document.getElement by class name. We get, again, all the class names that I have defined in my project. It doesn't matter if they're referenced on the same page as your JavaScript files are referenced. You get everything. So this makes it really, really easy to get a hold of all this stuff. So let's just do this. And finally, we can do get elements by tag name. Now, this is a static list of tag names. So we have header, for instance. This is pretty interesting because this is the first time in Visual Studio history that we can flow knowledge from the individual editors between other editors. So the list of tag names that you see here actually come from the HTML editor. We have a brand new HTML editor. We're going to look at that a little bit later. But as we update schema files for HTML, new browsers come out, new W3C standards emerge. That automatically flows into JavaScript like this. So I think the obvious question is, what about jQuery? Do we flow IntelliSense in there? I'm just asking a question on your behalf. So what about in here? I don't get any IntelliSense, right? This is very high on our backlog. We really want to do this. Because that's pretty complex. I want to provide full IntelliSense just like CSS selectors, because that's what we're doing here in jQuery. It's coming. We know how to do it. It's just not that simple, because we basically have to host the CSS editor inside the jQuery constructor. It's possible, but not trivial. It's coming. OK. So let's get rid of this. So in big teams, we are used to, from C# and managed code, to have some coding standards. We're used to having the compiler to help us figure out if we have unused variables, stuff like that. Then we have these tools on top of it, like StyleCop, FXCop, code analysis, and so on. JavaScript does not really have that. But it sort of does as well, because there are projects out there called, there's two that are really good that I like personally, that's JSLint and JSHint. Think of them as FXCop, StyleCop, and compiler warnings in the same at the same time. And through Web Essentials, we get that directly in the JavaScript editor. So let's take a look at the errors. As I save my document, this error list updates. And we can see that we have some undefined things going on. We're missing certain things. And that makes it really easy to enforce coding standards, right? So we're a big team, and now we can do all this stuff. And it's in here. And you might disagree with some of these rules. That's all fine. Because just like in code analysis in C#, for instance, we can set the parameters. And the way we do that is we just, I prefer to go to quick launch, control Q. We can just search for JS hint. And you see here are all the different parameters we can set. Right, they're, all of them are false, almost. I just have a few of them enabled. So you can mix and match. You can figure out exactly what are the coding standards that I need in my team. And if you're doing any minification of JavaScript, which I assume you do, right? You have to do that. Then very basic stuff like forgetting a semicolon becomes very important. This will figure that out for you and call it out. So really, really nice in big teams. All right. Any questions for JavaScript? OK. Oh, where? Yeah. Just yell out. Sorry.
What types are supported in the parameter bit?
What types are supported in the parameters? Functions and so on. Yes. Anything in JavaScript, even your own custom types. Right? So you can do function. And if you do, here I say x is a function. So if I call move, we can see that it takes a function. But you can actually go way deeper than that. And inside the parameters here, you can do another signature that has a summary and parameters. So that means if your code takes a callback as a parameter, you can also define in IntelliSense what are the parameters of the callback. Right? So you can really, really be very explicit about this stuff. I have some examples of that tomorrow afternoon when I go through Visual Studio extensibility, where this is one of the items. Was there one up here? Yep. How is TypeScript fitting in with all this? They're kind of separate. It's actually the same large team that does both. But they have their own tooling. They're getting close to releasing their 1.0 release. Their final or first version is almost done. But they're separate. So TypeScript generates JavaScript. But that's sort of the correlation between the two right now. We are looking at maybe for future versions, whether or not we should move the JavaScript IntelliSense engine to use TypeScript. But we don't know. That's just ideas. We're not there yet. Maybe it doesn't make sense, right? But we're looking at that. One more? Yep. Yeah. So the question is, if I say here that I want numbers, like in this case, but I instead do two strings, is there a warning? No, there is not. Is this a number? To JavaScript, it is, depending on your operator when you compare it. Right? So there are some issues. We're looking at whether or not we should enforce this. But there are some language intrinsics that make it kind of controversial. But it is something that I've raised the question a couple of times, and it's something we might look into, not for 2013, but maybe in an update or something. We don't know yet. OK, final one for JavaScript. There was one up here. No? Change your mind? It's OK. Yes? AngularJS, we're going to get back to that. All right. Cool. Now, let's take a look at, what is this? This is CSS. OK. I will not spend too much time in CSS. I usually spend a lot of time in CSS. Today, I will not. But I will show you just a few things. So in 2012, which most of you already run, awesome. You have a brand new CSS editor, right? Just as we did with JavaScript, we threw out the old CSS editor. It was old. It didn't know how to do CSS 3. And we built a brand new one, fully extendable, really, really, really nice. And we can now flow IntelliSense in CSS. So CSS is like this thing. You either love it or hate it. There's no in between, right? Let's just do a quick survey here. How many people love CSS? Wow, OK. This is probably the crowd where this many hands went up. This is like, we're at like 8% here or something. That never happens. It's usually like 3%. Okay. And there's a good reason why a lot of people, they don't like CSS. First of all, we don't know that what we're doing is going to work. There's no compiler. We don't get any errors. It's all a trial and error base. We sit with 8 browsers open, different browsers, and we have to, every time we change a line, we have to check if it works in all browsers. It is not a good experience. And I showed you yesterday, I'm not going to repeat how we are kind of helping out with some of the vendor specifics and those sort of things. But because a lot of people don't like CSS, they also don't learn it that well because they don't want to do it. But we all have to do it, right? By the way, I love CSS. I just want to make that clear. Anyway, we can now do flow IntelliSense again. So you're going to see this IntelliSense everywhere. That's kind of been a mantra. It was the highest voted for ticket on our asp.net.uservoice.com. IntelliSense everywhere. HTML, CSS, JavaScript, just flow it throughout the editor experience. And in CSS, we can now do stuff like this. So I showed you some of this yesterday, but I'll just continue here. Class names and IDs. As I type my ID, I now have IntelliSense for all the IDs in my CSS file, just in this file. Okay. We do the same for class names. We only show IntelliSense for the class names that are in your file, not for your entire project. This is not because we can't do it. This is on purpose. And please let me know if this is weird. I'll tell you why we do this. If you have, let's say you have multiple different CSS files, you might have one that's called menu.css, then you have contactspage.css, global.css, so on. If you do menu.css, why would you want IntelliSense for something that goes on somewhere else in the menu? Okay? So that's the reasoning behind it. It doesn't really add anything to mix between the files. Now, this is just like my idea. So please tell me is that a good idea or a bad idea? Thumbs up for a good idea that we only show it in the file. Okay, bad idea. We should show everything all the time. Good. Thanks. So, well, anyway, let's continue on here. And of course, we have for all the HTML elements show up here as well, right? Yes.
Do you ever think of showing the IDs and the classes of the HTML files and or PX files or whatever other? So not just the CSS files, but using the IntelliSense to pick up classes from other HTML files?
Yes. Very, very good question. So have we ever thought about showing IntelliSense for the class names and IDs that you just have in your HTML files, like your ASPX and your Razor files and HTML files? Yes, that would be really, really nice. We don't do that because parsing of all those things takes time. And we're going to store all that information in memory, in your memory, right? So so there are some performance issues with that, and there are some virtual memory issues with that. It is not like I'm not saying we're never going to do it. I'm just saying right now we're not going to do it because of that. But as the parsers get better and faster, we might actually end up doing it pretty soon. So again, we flow in IntelliSense from the HTML schema files right here. And as I showed you, I didn't show you this, we have for pseudo elements as well. And we can completely mix and match these things. So I can go in here and say dot, so header where it's not input validation error. And then this thing, and I just want to call out how it works, the thing I showed you yesterday, which was around attributes. So this is, again, this has been one of the highest voted for features. We want IntelliSense for attributes. So I showed you this thing where I do input, and then we get all the attributes that applies to the input element. And only those who applies to the input element. So we can do type equals, and now I get the values of the type attribute of the input element. Right? We're very, very specific here. Now, not always you have or you care about the specific HTML element. So you might want to just do this. You don't care what the HTML tag is, but you're going to say, yeah, I want all type attributes. And now you get values that applies to any HTML element that has a type attribute. So that includes stuff like, this is for the link tag, here's for the some audio tags, video tags is down here, script tags, all the elements that have a type attribute. And of course, the same goes here. We have it for input types too, right? So we now flow IntelliSense very, very seamlessly through everything, IntelliSense everywhere. Okay. Last thing I want to show in CSS, have you ever seen this syntax before? Margin with three values. So margin, just as a lot of other properties, describe the box model. Like padding is another one, right? Border radius, all these things where we have, where we're describing four sides of the box model, top, bottom, left, and right. Now I have three values. This is perfectly valid CSS. If you're like me, you forget or you don't know exactly which of these values applies to the top and bottom and left and right. That's kind of annoying, right? So we now have a little help here. So take a look at this. Notice the first line where it says syntax. This is my values. 20 pixels, auto, 3 pixels. Those are my values from the editor. And if you look at the second line, it describes exactly where in the box model these apply. So this also works for padding. It works for border radius and a few other of these type of box model properties. We also have this for background and font, which are these very long, very complex shorthand properties. So hopefully that's going to help a lot. CSS is always interesting. A lot of people are always getting bored when the, you know, when the conversation falls on CSS because it's not interesting. We really, really want to make CSS a first-class citizen, and I believe we have. So please reconsider the ones of the, all of you who does not like CSS to just give it a try. Use the tools. If you have Web Essentials was started out as a CSS tool. It only had stuff for CSS, improving the experience. So if you have Web Essentials, we're going to help you out with CSS to a degree that you will find nowhere else. Nowhere else. There is no comparison to the CSS support in Visual Studio versus anywhere else. All right. HTML. Let's not use that one. Let's use this one. Any CSS questions? Nope. Okay. So HTML, as I said, we have a brand new editor. And this is really, really awesome. We can now do things that we could not do before. The thing is with HTML, is with HTML5, with all the different clients that can now run HTML, such as the Windows Store apps and so on, it is becoming increasingly more important for different platforms, for different use cases, and so on. We needed a way to ensure that the HTML experience was on the very cutting edge at all times. This is very, very important. The old editor we had, it was actually from the 90s, right? It was old. We improved it over time, but it didn't really allow us to be on the cutting edge. There were limitations in what we could do. And especially when we're talking about IntelliSense everywhere, making it really, really easy to use HTML and so on, there was a lot of limitations. So let me just show you around the new HTML editor. I'm really, really proud of this. I love this HTML editor, and I hope that you will too. If you, those of you who used the preview, you've probably noticed that it is a step up. There were some issues in preview. In the final bits, it is brilliant. So let me show you some of the things that we can now do. So here I have a form, and I have two inputs here, an input element and a text area. And if I want to do a label for, let's say, the input element, it goes something like this, label for, now if I hit equals, we get IntelliSense for the input element. This does not seem like a big deal, right? But if you had If your IDs in these things came from like Razor code or something like that, it's just annoying that we have to repeat ourselves. We do not want to repeat ourselves. We are lazy, right? And we like to stay lazy. And so, so stuff like this just really, really helps out. Here's another one. So let's create a footer here with a copyright notice. And now I want to insert that little copyright symbol. We've all seen it, the circle with the C inside of it, right? How do you write that in HTML? I always forget how to do this. I know that it starts with an ampersand, and then it's, you know, some text, 3-4 letters, and then a semicolon. It's what's called an HTML entity. I always forget how to write these. There are so many different ones of them. So what I do is that I go to a search engine, and I will search for stuff like copyright HTML character. Right? I'll find somewhere online, and I will copy-paste it in or remember how it is. That's just not a very good workflow. We all know what happens when you go online. You hit the Facebook button, and 2 hours gone. So we want to stay in Visual Studio, right? So anyway, I know that it starts with an ampersand. So if I type an ampersand, look at this. We get all of the HTML entities with full preview. Cool, right? Okay. Have you all seen send coding? Let me show you some send coding. Send coding is a way to write HTML using CSS selector syntax. It goes like this. I want a section element with a div inside of it. Inside my div, I want 5 li elements, all of them with 3 words of lorem ipsum text. And I'm just going to hit tab. It's a good demo feature, right? I actually use this. It's not just for demos. Anywho, there are obviously issues here. The first thing I notice is that my lorem ipsum right here, the first element, I didn't mean it to be the first element. I want to move it down to the third position in my list. So I could just copy it down, or I could hold down the Alt key and just use the arrows up and down to move an entire line. Pretty nice. So this actually works in all the editors. This is not HTML specific. It'll work in C#, XML, JavaScript, whatever. Oh, but I have another error. My div, it shouldn't really have been a div because I'm doing a menu here. It should have been a nav. Nav is an HTML5 element. So as I type the start tag here, notice what happens in the end tag. It follows along. I can do it from down here. Yeah, that's this was actually in 2012, so this is not new. This was my favorite feature in 2012. I'm not even joking. This is one of the things that when you see it, it's like, yeah, I need it. I don't know how I was able to survive as a web developer for all those years without this thing. That's how I feel about it. But obviously, this is not good enough because I forgot the UL. So I can surround my text here with a UL. Like, I can go up here, do UL, copy this guy down here, insert it here. And that's fine, right? That's the workflow we're used to. Let's not do that anymore, shall we? Let's instead use a couple of things here in combination. We now have, this is through Web Essentials, we now have a way to expand our selection. This is super useful for all of you people out there that rather want to stay on the keyboard instead of using the mouse. By holding down Alt and hitting 1, the 1 key, and keep hitting it, we can walk up the tree. We can hit the Alt 2 to walk back down and end up where we started. That's really handy. So let's just select our LIs. And instead of using code snippets and surround with, which you might be familiar with, like this feature where you basically right-click and go in here and say, hey, surround with HTML, UL, and we get to this state, which in this case is wrong because it inserts a wrong, an additional li that I don't want. So instead of doing that, we can again use the Alt key in combination with Shift and W. For those of you who use Sublime Text, that is a shortcut key that should be familiar. It's to trigger a surround with feature. So Alt, Shift, W. And I can just change my start tag like this. It's pretty cool, huh? So stay on the keyboard, stay happy. I'm almost satisfied with my code. There is one thing here. I realized that the section tag I don't actually need. I want to keep my nav and everything in there, but I don't need the section tag. So I could, of course, go and delete them manually and all that. But what we have now was not that, but here. We now have very, very flexible smart tags in HTML. So we know smart tags from C#, right? This little blue thingy, glyph. So I can now say, remove and keep children, like this. Notice how formatting automatically adjusts. It's all about the details. It's all about the details.
You did that with a mouse. Can you do it with a keyboard?
You can do that with a mouse. Can you do it with a keyboard? How do you invoke a smart tag everywhere in Visual Studio? What's the keyboard shortcut? Control dot. Let's try it. Yes. This is the universal key for that. There are issues in the preview with that, actually, in HTML, so it's a good question. Don't worry. In the final bits, it will work absolutely perfectly. Okay. So let's take a look at how this surround with works, because I want to just drive a point home here. So let's just write some text. I'm going to select this text. Everything that is selected as I invoke surround with, Alt-Shift-W, will be surrounded. And I can make this a span very easily, right? If I don't select anything, if my cursor is somewhere in here or it's in the end tag or whatever, and I then invoke surround with, it will take whatever tag my cursor is in. So let's just do that again. Alt-Shift-W. We can do a div. All right, so very, very flexible. Here's something that, please give me your feedback, shout out if you think this is a bad idea. We do not have it in Visual Studio 2013. We've added it to Web Essentials because we're not exactly sure if this is too much of a, But basically, let's say that I want to do this. I want to move, so my cursor is right here. And then I want to hit Enter because I want the span tag to be on the next line. If I want to do that, I probably also want the end div tag to be on the line below that, right? At least that's what I'm thinking. So if I hit enter, that's what you're going to get. What if I want to do it here? What would the expected behavior be here? These are some of the things that we try to wrap our head around and say, okay, if I hit enter here, what should happen? Now, what I think should happen is that I want span to be on a new line, and I want some text to be yet again on a new line. And the end text should kind of follow on, again, new lines as well, like this. OK, I take it that you think this is a good idea then. We're not going to roll it in. We don't have time to roll it into 2013 for the final release. But we're probably going to roll it into an update or something like that. But OK, that's good. Thank you for the feedback on that. That's good. OK. So with iOS, Windows 8, IE 9 Plus, we have, and Twitter and Facebook and so on, there's a lot of what we call environment integration points, right? If you want to pin your site to your Windows 8 home screen, we as web developers can control the tile that's being created. Like, what is the picture on there? What is the background color? We can even flow in all this dynamic content and so on. And the same goes for our iOS. If we, what should the image be on your home screen if you pin it to the home screen? So on. We have all that stuff built in now. So let's just take a look. So let's say that we want to play around with Twitter, because we also have Twitter integration. A Twitter card basically makes us, the web developer, in charge of what it looks like when people link to our web pages. The way that it's represented in Twitter, that everyone else is going to see, we can control, like, what is the description, what is the image, is there a logo, and so on, which is really, really cool. And we have full support for that. Let's just zoom in here. So here you see some Apple iOS. We have some MS application for Windows 8 and IE and all that stuff. But we also have Twitter. Twitter card is one of them. So you see here, I now get full IntelliSense. This is very interesting. I actually get IntelliSense in my content attribute based on the value of the name attribute. Okay? So let's do this. Let's do another one. Let's do MS application, yada, 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 and invoke the and do content again. The IntelliSense is different. IntelliSense everywhere, context-based IntelliSense. This is new game. This is just an example of what this is, right? But for me, as an HTML editor kind of designer, this is close to the holy grail. The last thing I want you guys and myself as a web developer to be doing is to be unproductive by having to go to a search engine and search for stuff. Stuff that the editor should provide. And this helps a great deal with that. I hope you agree. Oh, there's a shortcut key for Outlook. I didn't know that. Okay, so there is a new concept that's not really new, but it's new in HTML5. It's called RDFA. I don't know what RDFA stands for, I'll be honest. I've been using it for many years. So when back in the day when I built blockengine.net, it was full RDFA compatible. I still really don't know what it means. But what's really nice these days is that we have Facebook who are spearheading in the Open Graph APIs, which is a protocol and a standard that we can leverage. We now have full support for Open Graph. And here's how it works. We now get a new property called property. And look at this. We can go in and do Open Graph specific things. Here are all the most important Open Graph things. We, as a developer, we want to use Open Graph to control what happens when people link to our sites on Facebook. Facebook is the first website that really takes advantage of Open Graph, but it is a standard, and we are going to see more of it around the web. So for instance, let's just say that my page is doing some audio stuff. We still use the content attribute, but look, we get IntelliSense specific to this property. So this is really sweet. But, there's a problem. Let's see what the problem is. The prefix attribute on the head element is missing. Okay. So let's do the prefix. Okay, now we have a prefix. I said Facebook here. The error is still there. Why is that? It's because I used the wrong value in my prefix attribute. So, okay. Let's change it to OG for Open Graph. And the error disappears. This is, for validation purposes, really interesting. Because this is context-aware validation. So we can do context-aware IntelliSense, but we can also do context-aware validation. And we have gone to great length with our validator to make sure that we no longer cause you any grief. We're not going to call out stuff that we all know works, because it works in all browsers, but maybe the W3C don't like it, right? It's an old standard or something like that. So we can target very, very surgically our validation. But let me just show you exactly what I mean by what we're doing. So font tags. We love the font tag, right? What we did was we created a robot, and we sent it out on the web, downloading thousands of real-world HTML documents. And we ran them all through our validator, and we figured out what are the tags that people actually use. And people actually use the font tag a lot. They use stuff like center tag. They use attributes that haven't existed since HTML 3.2, because all the browsers support them. We do not want the validator to tell you that something is wrong when clearly it is not. So if you want to use the center tag, it's not going to be squiggled. If you misspell it, then it will be. We know about the center tag now. This seems pretty stupid, doesn't it? But consider this. Let's do a div and a line. This is perfectly valid HTML 401. We're not going to give you IntelliSense for it because it's not really valid anymore. Maybe you shouldn't be using it. If you want to use it or if you have legacy code that uses it, well, we're going to help you out still. So you are going to get IntelliSense if you decide to opt into it by using it. So by doing it this way, I think it's pretty clever. We are backwards compatible and support all your existing stuff, but we do it in a very unobtrusive way, kind of maybe leading you to a better solution, I think. So I don't know if you think this is fine. I think this is pretty elegant. AngularJS, question from before. Okay. Let's do AngularJS. How many people here use some sort of Angular, Ember, Knockout, JavaScript, something, client templating? Okay, a good portion of you, 10% or so. They can sometimes be a little bit difficult. In 2012, update 2, we added full support for Knockout binding expressions in HTML. We actually give you IntelliSense of your JavaScript object model inside the HTML editor. It is insanely good. I didn't think we could do it because it's sort of magical, but we did. And now we do some stuff with Angular as well. So let's turn this page into an Angular app. So one thing that we're doing, so all of you who use 2012, you know that the attribute list on HTML elements is pretty long. And we have a lot of these ARIA attributes. Now we just have one. We do the same for Angular. We just have one. Angular starts with NG. And as soon as I type the hyphen, it opens up. And I can say this is an Angular app. Okay? So let's do a div down here. Now I want to create an Angular controller. So I do ng controller. And I'm just going to call it Matt here. So one of the things that I think is really, really interesting is how we can flow feature discovery and sort of code generation directly into the context you're in at the moment. And right now, the context I'm in is that I'm doing Angular controller. So we now have IntelliSense. Sorry, smart tag that says add new Angular controller. We realize that you're doing something here with an Angular controller. So let's just hit that. And I can say, yeah, put it in my scripts. It automatically figures out that the name should be matched because that was the value of my property. I can just save it. And here it shows up. And we can see here that we have all the values replaced. It's really nice. This is actually John Papa. Thank you. This is just a prototype. This is just to see, like, does it make sense? I take it that at least one guy here thinks it's a good idea. So that's awesome. But I really want to discover all the different things that we can do by generating code based on where you are and what you're doing. And I think this is kind of the first prototype on that. And we're going to throw a lot more into Web Essentials. But if you have any ideas, let me know. I brought pen and paper for that specific reason. So let me know. OK. So this was the HTML editor. One thing I want to call out before we end the HTML here is formatting. It is really not very good in 2012 and before that. If you do format document and format selection, it does weird things. You cannot trust the formatter. We spent probably the longest, way longer than I ever thought possible and needed to create a formatter for the new HTML editor to make sure that whatever you type is going to end up being formatted correctly. We no longer wrap everything, do all new lines, and insert all sorts of stuff. The way you write HTML is the way that we're going to format it. If you want to have code like this, and you format the document, control KD, it stays like this. We don't put the span on the new line, for instance, as we would have done in the old editor. If you have ULLIs and tables and all that stuff, you know that you can't trust the formatter. But now you can. And that's also why we want to do stuff like this. Because we want it so that whatever you type is going to end up being the same formatted code you would get if you say format document. Okay? So you no longer ever, ever, ever have to do format document. The way you type it is already taken care of. Indentation is correct, and all these things automatically. This was a huge pain. It took 6 months. I'm not even kidding. This was so complex to figure out. Quick question. If you want to format document, you do. What would the point of it be? Well, if you open a file that someone else did, right? Yeah. Or a minified document, right? Anywho, so this was some, we had some Angular here as well. Now, there's a lot of things that we do not provide you out of the box in Visual Studio. And one of them could be Angular controllers. You could see here how we, through Web Essentials, could kind of generate those things. But we have a new project that we're building, which is open source, and it's completely community-driven. We're providing the building blocks for this, but basically what it is, it's a very simple way to create templates, item templates, and project templates. And here's how it works. Let's say that I have this Angular controller right here, right? Let's just delete that guy. Go. I want to add an Angular controller in a different way. I can say add new item, and we now have this node down here called side waffle. And we have a lot of stuff. Angular controllers, all sorts of stuff. This is very early, so we don't have that many things. But it's super easy. Let's just do Angular controller. Again, let's call it Mads. And we get the exact same thing. And here's one of my favorites. How often do you have to do a robots.txt file? Not very often, right? But we kind of have to do it. There's a very good reason why we need a robots.txt file in the root of our documents. If we just want search engines to index everything in our page, that's fine. Then from a search engine perspective, we don't need a robots.txt. But the search engines are still going to hit the URL. And that means we're going to serve a 404 page. That could be a heavy load depending on if you have custom 404 pages and so on. So let's just always have a robots.txt. And now we can do that very, very easily. Right-click up here on the project, add new item. Where'd you go? Yep. And let's do robots.txt. It's here. And now we're here. So we now laid down the file robots.txt, which we need. You should add it if you don't have one. But look at this. We have colorization. So here's what happened. I was sitting around and figured out, like, building a website, and I needed to do robots.txt. And I got frustrated that I could not figure out how to do robots.txt from memory. Because it's so rare that I do it. You have to go somewhere online and search for it and all that. So I decided, hey, it would be cool if we at least have like syntax highlighting so we could show whether or not things look good or not. But then I thought, hey, it would also be cool if we had IntelliSense. So this was just because I was frustrated about lacking tools for a text file. And it took me like an hour to write all this. Again, come to my extensibility talk tomorrow. This is the level of detail that I want as a web developer. This is not important, I think. We can all agree this is not important. It's a nice to have. But what would you rather be doing? Only need to haves, or would you like a lot of nice to haves? The way I see it is, if it doesn't hurt performance, I want all the nice to haves. Keep me out of search engines for doing stuff that I just need to do as part of my work. This is kind of plays into that pretty well. Okay, Let me close all this. Nope. And let's make the switcher. Browser link. I want to talk to you about this. So you have, the kind of the workflow that we're used to as web developers is a workflow that has not changed since we started building websites. We have our editor on one side, and we have the browsers and the clients on the other side. They are two separate ecosystems. The browser does not know about Visual Studio. The browser only knows that when it hits a URL, it gets some content back that it can understand, like HTML and JavaScript and CSS. But it only knows about the URL. It doesn't know whether or not we're running ASP.NET or PHP or static files or whatnot. It has no idea. Visual Studio doesn't know about the browsers either. All right? This goes for all text editors, basically. They don't know about the browser. They might know that there is a server. In the case of Visual Studio, we know there is a server, right? But we do not know about the browsers. It's almost as if there is like a virtual barrier in between those two. Very rich ecosystems exist on both sides, but it's a complete separate experience we have to go through, and we don't even think about it because it's always been like this. So the idea and the dream behind Browser Link is to break the barrier and combine the two ecosystems so that everything the browser knows about and the browser can do natively as a browser, but also through extensions, browser extensions, and so on, all that can be flown into Visual Studio. And everything that Visual Studio knows about, your project, your source files, the server, all these different things can be flown into the browser. So we get a full 100% bi-directional connection between the two, basically combining the two ecosystems. So what is Browser Link? It is an open standard-based WebSocket connection. Absolutely nothing proprietary is going on. It's JavaScript and it's WebSockets. And we're using SignalR. So here's what we do. We host SignalR. For those of you who do not know what SignalR is, it's sort of an ASP.NET wrapper. Well, not necessarily ASP.NET, but it's a wrapper around, a .NET wrapper around WebSockets, this HTML5 WebSockets. A WebSocket is basically a true socket connection that browsers understand, HTML5 browsers understand. So we host a WebSocket endpoint inside Visual Studio. Visual Studio now becomes a server itself, which is kind of strange. And then we use ASP.NET automatically to inject a little piece of JavaScript on your code. And before you freak out about injecting JavaScript, just let me reassure you, it is not harmful. And we're going to get back to that. So this is just open standards. When the JavaScript runs in your browser, it will connect to Visual Studio, creating this bidirectional channel. We're going to look at that JavaScript a little bit later. So there we go. So let's take a look. Let's run this website. Of course, I showed you some of this stuff yesterday really, really quickly. So let's take a little bit of deeper dive here. So here is, I'm just using one browser here. Let's look at the code. Okay, here we go. This is what the ASP.NET engine injects into our page. That is all. It only injects the JavaScript onto your page if you run in debug mode, right? Debug equals true in your web config. It only injects the JavaScript if you're on localhost. It only injects the JavaScript if you have Visual Studio open on with the same project open that your browser is currently requesting pages from. So there's a lot of stuff that we do to make this a development tool. You don't really have to worry about sending this out in production. It's not going to follow. Even if your production server has Visual Studio installed and it runs in debug mode, then the request does not come from localhost and nothing happens, right? But you have to have like a lot of things to actually, by accident, have this in production. So it's not really an issue at all. But this is basically it. And look at what we have here. Async. This does not intervene with your page load. By using async, we're basically removing the entire JavaScript parsing to happen in the background in the browser. You're not going to feel anything here. There is no performance hit. If your browser does not support WebSockets, because we use SignalR, it just falls back to long polling and forever frame and so on, so it works like in down-level browsers, old browsers. So this just works. You don't have to worry about it. We inject a little bit of code here. It's all good. It's actually so good that if you run performance analysis tools like PageSpeed from Google and Yahoo's YSlow, this is not going to have a negative impact. We've made sure of that. First of all, you want to run your performance tools running in release mode anyway, right? But even if you do it in debug mode, this is not going to intervene. You're still going to get your good score. So we are very, very careful that we don't ruin anything. Okay? All right. So here's what we have for you. Let's just take a look here. Let me go here just to make the point clearer. We have a new button. And as I hover it, we can see we have one browser connected. It's Chrome, and it's on the home/about URL. And this is built into Visual Studio. It was in the preview, too. If I hit the button up here, the browser refreshed. It's so fast here, nothing changed, right? But of course, we have a keyboard shortcut, so Control-Alt-Enter. And that allows us to do really, really nice things like this. Tagged, Control-Alt-Enter. Boom. In all my connected browsers. So let's actually do this, because I think this is kind of cool. I want to drive home this point. Okay, let's remove this. This is undo. Control-Alt-Enter. It works in emulators. No plugins are needed. There's absolutely no browser plugins needed to do any of this. It's just JavaScript. So one of the new things that we have is that we have a dashboard, browser link dashboard. It shows us what browsers that we have connected. We have Chrome and we have Safari for iPhone. It shows us the URL. And if we have any connection issues, it will show it down here. This is very early UI, so it looks like kind of weird, maybe. But it kind of tells us all these things. It actually says if we have HTML files, it will call out, well, hey, maybe you need to run this in your web config. Run all managed modules for all requests. Set it to true. That will enable browser link for static HTML files. You don't need to have, you know, use ASP.NET as long as you have a web config where you can set this. Then it all works for static files. So that's pretty nice. Let me show you something that was one of the key drivers from the beginning. Even though we wanted browser link to work without a single plugin in any browser, we wanted to make sure that it was usable from a browser plugin if you so choose to write one. I wrote one. So here's Chrome, and I have a little extension that shows up automatically. When I'm on a page that has browser link loaded, it shows the Visual Studio logo in the address bar. And if I click it, I can go into inspect mode and design mode. And we saw inspect mode, right? This is basically page inspector in the browser. Is this good? Do you like this feature? Okay, thank you. I was nervous for a second there. And then, of course, my favorite here is the design mode. Now, just a quick word about that. This is all from Web Essentials. Browser link does only two things in the box. It creates the entire infrastructure with a full API. And then it handles that browser refresh thing, that button I click that refresh the browsers. It does nothing but that. So it's up to us developers to extend the functionality. And I've done that by using here, for instance, in design mode. And you saw this yesterday. I could click here. It would show my action link. And as I type in the browser, it changes in my C sharp. This is C sharp, right? The limit here now is you have to refresh to change another element. So one of the things that we're going to do for hopefully the first update is to get around this issue where the problem with that I can only edit one element at a time unless I do a browser refresh, it's because the source mapping, we actually do source mapping between browser and server, now becomes out of sync. By doing a refresh, we kind of go back to normal and now everything is in sync. So for when 2013 RTMs, that's going to be the same thing, but we're going to fix that. It's pretty complex, but it's really compelling. And of course, it doesn't have to be action links. We can do the same. I don't need my Chrome extension to invoke all of this. I can do Control Alt D for design. And let's just do. We can do stuff. We're going to do stuff here, right? Like this. If I undo, I'm still in the browser. If I undo, Control C. It actually uses Visual Studio's own undo. So if something bad happens for whatever reason, it's Visual Studio's own undo. So that means I can, and you see here, it's saved. The document is not dirty, right? It's saved, so I can just hit F5. I'm still in the browser. I never left the browser, and I'm back to where I started by using Visual Studio's own undo. Pretty cool. Before we get to the end, let me just show you a couple of things. We can do stuff now that we could never do before that I've always wanted to do. And this might seem like a small thing to you guys, but this might be one of the most exciting things for me. What happened? Okay. And this is these errors right here. Take a look at this. Specify the page description using a meta tag. We have never been able statically to figure out if you have a certain meta tag in your HTML. We can't do it until now. Why can't we do it? Because you could inject meta tags from your code behind files and web forms or through controls or third-party controls and so on and user control, all these sort of things that happens dynamically on the server. Statically, we could not do it with 100% confidence until we actually run the site, but now we do. And we can just use JavaScript to analyze the page and figure these things out. So I have JavaScript running that asks if or figures out whether or not I have a meta tag. And it says here, SEO, search engine optimization, you need a meta tag. OK, it's fine that it says I need one. Let's just close all my files here. But it says double click to fix it. We are used to, when we double click an arrow, that it will take us to the line of code, the offending line of code, right? It doesn't have to be that way. We can do whatever we want. So what I've chosen to do here in this case is I'm going to pop up this thing asking, hey, do you want to insert a description meta tag? Oh, yes. Thank you. And now it's inserted. It knew that it was in the layout file. It knew to find the header because browser link knows exactly where your header element maps to in your source code. So we can now do all these things that was impossible before. You might have seen web dev checklists. This is the thing I showed you earlier, web dev checklist. What are the things we need to do to improve our site? Oh, we need to make sure it validates. We need to make sure that we have good SEO. We need to make sure yada, 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 a lot of different things. So instead of doing that after we're done, if we can flow that in, all that information, and give you help, give you hints, just double click and we'll fix it for you. The entire quality of your site is automatically just going to be improved by having it as part of your natural workflow, right? So we no longer have to take you to, the customer don't want to pay for you to do this extra work. But now it's there. We just do it because it comes in naturally. So for me, I think this is the big draw. I'm not sure it is for you, but that's how I think that we can really help a lot of developers to do really cool stuff this way. So this was just a very, very brief example of what that could look like. Of course, we have the web developer checklist up here as well as Chrome extension. I wrote it, so this is, yeah. I like this. Anywho, Here's a thing that you have been asking for so long, and we have never, ever been able to do it. And I'm really happy that we now have this. It's very, very early, but you know this problem. You're developing your website. You know, you're on iteration 5 or whatever. You have a huge project. And what about your CSS? Are there any unused CSS rules? You want to clean up your code, but you don't really know if you have any CSS that doesn't apply anymore. Right? Old. It's not being used anywhere. So we can now do that. So if we go up here again, we can say, hey, take a snapshot of the CSS usage from all the browsers connected. In this case, I only have one. Oh, I have Safari as well. And we immediately figure out on this page that I'm on, what are my unused CSS rules? And if I click it, it will take us in. And notice how it will automatically just kind of gray out the things that are not used. So this is pretty cool to figure out if your front page, how much of the CSS that you actually load on that page is being used. And we automatically say anything in Bootstrap or those known framework or libraries, we're going to ignore that. And that you can extend that ignore list to other stuff as well. But this makes it really flexible. But what we really want to do is that we want to record it. So we can use the browser link dashboard to go in and say, Chrome, start recording. And I'm just going to browse around here. Let's go to register. This guy. We can go back in, stop recording. Now my list is shorter. So we can now find all this dead code. So I'm going to leave it up here. We have a few minutes for questions. What I will say about browser link is it is not what we think is right that's important. We do not provide features. We have our experimental web essentials that you should all go download, of course, that adds a lot of features. But the key here is we want you to write features. Tomorrow I'm going to show you how to do it. Visual Studio extensibility can be like uphill battle to begin with. There are some complexities in there. Browser link extensions for Visual Studio is the easiest extension you could write. One C# class, one JavaScript file. I'm going to show you tomorrow. So with that in mind, demo, we did that. Here's my Twitter. I'm going to keep you updated with everything new, Visual Studio and ASP.NET, and BrowserLink. BrowserLink is our newest family member in the tooling, so there's going to be a lot of that stuff. Web Essentials is out in preview, so you can actually get it for your Visual Studio 2013. And all the stuff I showed you here will be available to you at some point in the near future. Web Essentials is open source. All the stuff I showed you in BrowserLink, HTML validation, all these things, you can go watch. See what the code is like. It's all up on GitHub. Okay, any questions? We have a few minutes. Here's one.
You mentioned with the browser link that it only works for local hosts. I do a lot of mobile dev. I've actually been going to tap into my local machine on my mobile device.
Yeah. Will browser link only work on local hosts? Or what if I have a mobile phone that I want to see what my website looks like? Today, that's problematic. You cannot really just point your phone to your machine. If you run localhost, you have to change your IIS bindings to your machine name and so on. This is one thing that we're going to do. We're going to open up completely so you can, from any device, you can just punch in your machine name and you can see what your website is looking like on an actual device. When we do that, browser link will work with that. It is coming. Yes, sir. If I write an Angular directive, will IntelliSense parse that? No, we don't have that yet. We're trying to figure out how to provide that level of IntelliSense and knowledge about individual libraries. It seems like Angular is sort of winning these days. It's really popular. Backbone is not being used that much anymore. So yeah, we will definitely take a look at how we can do with Angular just as we did with Knockout. But we don't have it out of the box in 2013. It's going to come later. Probably in an update. Here's one up there.
With your old arrow feature that you do, list items,
yep.
Does that work for blocks of HTML as well, moving divs within
Yeah, question is, when I move the line by holding down Alt and then use arrows up and down, what if I select like a block and you and do the same thing? It will totally work. It will take all those lines and move them in synchronicity. Yeah. Yes, sir? Will the CSS work on CSS preprocessors, less SAS stylus? Yes. We only ship less in the box. The next thing we're going to do is to have SAS. Right? We want to finish less. We're not quite there yet. There are some language and syntactics that we don't have yet, so we're going to give you errors where no error should be. That's the first thing we're going to do and give you an update on that. As soon as that's done, we're going to do SAS. And you're going to have the exact same thing, the experience in Web Essentials that gives you all this nice browser logos when you hover over properties and all that stuff is going to work on all the preprocessors, at least for SAS and less.
All the unused stuff, the unused CSS.
Sorry?
The unused CSS classes.
The unused CSS classes will not work for less yet. We need to have source mapping support more finalized to be able to do that. But when we do, yeah, then definitely. All right, time is up. Thank you, guys. Please remember, yes. Remember to win a mouse.